in the talk we had just before at dinner, you said there is one zone that I can't ask questions about, which was a personal.
Go for it.
Sorry?
Go.
No, actually, my question is, of course, there is your work that has a certain atmosphere, maybe a certain hopelessness in it. I was careful to say it, but okay, no, hopeless. And then there's, of course, you as a person. How does your personal view correspond with... is it maybe, first of all, is it an interesting question? And second of all, is there a discrepancy between the two?
No. No, of course not. No, it's as an artistic practice, I searched for... I could do the comedy or the tragedy. And I chose for the tragedy in my work. Mm-hmm. So I
and a comedy in your life.
Of course, happy joy.
okay, no, but this is quite an important choice to make, right? Was it a conscious choice?
Almost, yeah.
Okay.
I was a bit tempted to attracted to the dark. Otherwise, I wouldn't do it. But no, it's the because I even think that if you look at Mr. Lynch. Mm-hmm. David, actually, there's if you of or even worse, Romeo Castellucci.
Worse?
No, also dark.
Okay. Yes.
If I did meet Mr. Castellucci, I'm afraid not Lynch, but both of them are very gentle, nice, happy people. The thing is that it's even the energy I think you need to. To have the energy to try to understand to have a dialogue with dark and etc. difficult things, mm-hmm. And that's a lot of energy you need to, and in that sense you have to almost feel well to dive into it and not to go down with that matter.
Oh, it's so dark.
Fuck. So no.
Yes, so you're diving. No. I understand. So there is actually. Is it a cathartic thing to do? No, it doesn't have anything to do with.
No, it's a hobby. It's. It's really like the dog playing with the slippers. It's just the fun of trying to understand the most darkest things.
Yes.
And then creating to do something with it. That is for me as an artist the most constructive thing you can do. And the most positive thing you can do is trying to change it, to transform it into an object or a performance or whatever it might be. Mm-hmm. And for that, you just that's a very positive thing to do something and to have a dialogue and to work.
Mm-hmm. A word I heard in your talk was empathy. Mm-hmm. Yes. And I think, and also, for example, you talked about Heiner Müller, and we could see these people as extremely dark, or Beckett is also a big inspiration, or maybe people who show us some empathy. Maybe we don't find the answers in the pieces, but maybe we can find, fill in, I don't know, a way of dealing?
A way of dealing, It's the Ballardian saying, this is somehow in their view what is going on. Fail once, fail more, fail better. Beckett is one of the most almost empathetic and hopeful things you can say. It's the failing is not failing. It is something you can learn from. It's a positive thing. You can evolve. Except to fail once, fail more, fail better feels a bit dark. That's very true, yes. Mm-hmm.
Maybe back to Christoph, because your standpoint is talk and act, although maybe in this acting might be futile, or is that too dark?
No, it's true, because all acts are actually very small, and I can only hope that it gets copied, so... that a lot of small acts can change something, but I guess we need to be scared sometimes to act, because we're now living in a very cozy, we're all living cozy life here in Western Europe, and I think we need to be scared to dare to act because we have got lots to lose. Maybe we need hopelessness to do something about it, because we have to dare to lose, I guess.
Isn't there a risk to make us immobile?
Yes, and we need maybe the immobilization at first, because also in my work I have to experience depression. And I'm not attracted to light. I'm actually more afraid of the dark. So then I run into the light. But I'm not attracted to the light. I just run away from darkness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you think maybe your practices aren't so far apart then from each other in core, let's say?
No, we understand each other very well, I guess.
No, but and I do respect a lot of the ecological. I think it's just the same story we are saying. It's just the form and the way it shows itself is completely different. But deep inside, there's just an empathetic and a huge concern about this little ball we live on. It's just the approach the approach and the maybe the approach is the same, but the result is maybe different.
Yes. Did you all drink the potion, Sue?
Yes.
Chris, you also drank the potion?
Of course.
Oh. Did anybody didn't drink the potion? 1, 2, 3 people. Oh. We're all consciously poisoned, actually, by the Anthropocene. But maybe this was also, that's what you said, we could all cozily drink, eat, not asking ourselves any questions, although we were eating poison, perhaps, and now you made us a little bit more conscious about it. So you didn't doubt before you drank?
That it would be bad for me? What do you mean about it?
Yes. Did you have any doubts before you drank the potion?
Yes. I'm not going to say no, but I don't really know how it will add up. And he said it wouldn't take effect till 70, so that would make me 127. I'm not planning to live, or 126. I'm not planning to live that long. No, I don't know. I think we have to take a lot. I was at a performance today that I'm sure polluted me more than that. So
what kind of a performance?
Well, this guy had firecrackers in his ears, and then he lit them on fire, and red dust went all over the room. And we all, after 10 minutes of that, we had to leave.
Okay.
I think I still smell like it. But anyway.
So actually, art is polluting and bad for your health.
It can be
basically.
Easily. A lot of art can be.
Yeah.
I think Chris has an interesting point of view about artists and polluting.
No, I have not. No way. No, I have this V6 engine, this beautiful machine, V6 engine, Alfa Romeo, one of the best engines ever made in the 70s. It was the basics for Ferrari. Beautiful machinery. 160 horsepower. You know, of course you know. And it's one of the most incredible machines that are made. It's handmade. There's no computer thing going on, and it's such a métier wise. It's an incredible invention. It influenced this thing, this horror we invented, was the most powerful. I think it's one of the most powerful objects we made last century, and it had a huge influence on everything. And at one, so what I do is I put the engine on, and it goes to flames in I mean with flames out. I have other ones that explode, but not this one. It's very bad for the people around it because they're really polluted for 1 minute and a half. all the exhaustion stuff and I don't know what. The thing is that National Portrait Gallery asked me to show it because it was an ecological festival around. And I said, yeah, of course, let's go for it. And security-wise, we had all problems, open flames, exhaustion. We had every problem. And then after months and months of work, because people had to be in suits with gas masks on to walk around this machine that 10 million cars each day in London alone. And I couldn't put my engine on. I was shocked. Mm-hmm. There was a letter when I did it at Kai Theater, the engine. I had a letter in the Standard about somebody of Gaia saying, you pollute. I don't even have a license to drive. He went home to Ghent with his car.
Yes.
People say to me when they see the car, this is not in my car. Mm-hmm. You've got two, honey bun. I mean, it's so incredible. We are crazy.
Yes.
No, but I mean, sorry, on the pollution.
Yes, but I think you, you stroke actually the important conclusion. If we can draw any conclusions of tonight, that artists unveil things, or in this context, artists unveil things that we maybe don't see, that can show us perspectives on a possible future, on a possible now. And I would love to invite you all to sit down, because we are going to the last part of tonight.